The Tabletop Bellhop is here to answer your gaming and game night questions. Tonight's question comes from local game designer Roger Malosh, who writes, "Hey Mo, thank you for doing such a great job answering my question about the burden of reading the rules. I was playing Concordia the other day and realized again what a great game it is. It's simple, elegant, and has enough depth to keep anybody happy. The same can be said about Acquire and other games that might be considered gaming classics. It's a shame that these games seem to fade into the background as the new hotness grabs everyone's attention. It would be cool if you had a short segment on your show where you mention one of these classic games. Maybe you can call it Looking Back or Meeple Memories or Classics Corner. I would love to hear what you and Sean and Dee now consider classic board games. These games shouldn't be forgotten."
Well, thank you very much, Roger, for the great question and the suggestion. Wow, that came out weird. Show suggestion. honestly, we've talked about this. We've talked about it multiple times. It's come up before. We've had multiple people in our chat room suggest some kind of segment, especially every time we're like, we're not about the new hotness. Or like, well, then you should highlight some older stuff as well. And we've talked about it and waffled on it. And the whole problem is, and honestly, like, maybe if we do another poll this year, we can see where people fall. Do people want the show to get longer? That's the whole problem. Right now, we try aim for 2 hours. Sometimes we're a bit over, sometimes we're a little under. But in general, our shows are 2 hours long. That's a pretty long for a podcast. Now, I know there's longer shows out there and there's a lot of shorter ones out there. But if we took a segment, even say once a month, once a week, whatever, I think we could probably do it every episode. There's probably enough games to talk about. But if we did throw a new segment in the show, either it comes at the expense of something else, which I would say, fine, we'll do two reviews and one of them will be classic. The problem with that is we need to get through the current pile of obligation.
We've talked about this before. I want to acquire, play, and talk about all the weird, quirky old games. Like when we were in an antique store up at Mo's uncle's place and we found a game called Warp Out, which the box promised us was about both the Bermuda Triangle and Atlantis. A family game of suspense and chance from 1985. I brought it downstairs so I could show you all the awesome monsters. How can you not want to play that? It was $5. We had to buy it. And I thought it would be a hoot to play this and talk about it on the show, but it's still sitting in the pile of shame. Or like one of our fans sent Mo a copy of The Generals, and I want to play that and talk about that. But I doubt that's what Roger meant by classics. But if you're talking new potential show segments, that is the one I want to do.
You see, I'd actually be really interested in Goodwilling and thrift shopping and, you know, finding the junk, finding those leftover forgotten gems, not classics. In fact, they're probably for the most part horrible games, but interesting from a historical standpoint, especially looking back in comparison to what we think of as hobby board games or even more, even modern mass market games, which are so different from games of the 70s, 60s and earlier.
Right. Or like that round Connect Four like game that Mo and I played a few weeks back at the brewery. I want to find all the quirky stuff like that, bring it home, play it and talk about it, because I think that'd be neat.
See,
I said, I don't think that's Roger's question.
Well, my thing is, I think we'd want to mix it up. I think we would want to do, I honestly think it's worth talking about, you know, games that are 20, 30, 40 years old that are still good, as well as those weird retro. If we had a segment, I'd like once a month we do a 13th. We used to do a segment whenever we talked about really old games. We called it the 13th floor. Like you're in our hotel and you get off on the wrong floor. You get off on the 13th floor. And we always say, welcome to the 13th floor. You know, it's 1962 and you're coming around the corner and you see this game. And it's something we did a long time ago. I would love to bring back. And like some of those could be quirky games. And other times it'd be like you get off the 13th floor and it's 2000. And here's the hot game of 2000. But again, the whole problem is we can do this, but the show get longer. I personally don't have a problem with the show getting longer, but Sean's the one that thinks it's too long as it is. And I think Dee's kind of in the middle. So I don't know what people are willing to put up with, I guess is the right word. If we become a 3 hour, 4 or 5 hour show like The Secret Cabal, they've got lots of fans. So there's definitely a market out there for it. And they can have all kinds of different segments and different shows, and we can change it. So 1 week we have these four segments, and the next time we have these five, and the next one we only have three. So I don't know. I guess we'll just keep talking about it. Like if you want the segment bad enough, like I said, the problem is if we want to stick to our 2 hour time limit, we'd have to get rid of something else. We'd have to, I don't know, shorten the Ask the Bellhop. We switch our game recommendation episodes like tonight instead of discussing ahead of time what is a good train game or what is a train game or what is a classic game. We just go, here's our top. X, yeah. 15, here's 5 each.
No, right? The debate's again, the fun part.
Yeah, I think a lot of what people I think like out of this is the discussion and
right.
You know, game wrecks are a dime a dozen. Everyone has done game wrecks. You know, IGN just bought Dicebreaker and, you know, more game wrecks coming there and all that.
I don't know. So right now, I don't think we're going to bring the 13th floor back right away, but it is something we will consider doing. So what I want to do tonight to at least, you know, help Roger out, instead of a new segment, how about a show? So that's what we're here tonight to do. We are going to do a show on our favorite classic games and games that shouldn't be forgotten, games that may be being overshadowed by the new hotness. But first, we got to talk a bit about what a classic game is, because independently, all of us kind of came up with a list of 5 games each, and we were all on very different pages.
So interestingly, I think somebody in the chat room today has already said something that I failed to express when we were discussing and writing some of this stuff earlier, because to me, classic is a pretty unspecified term. A piece of literature might need to be 100 years old. A car might need to be 50. A video game might be 10 years old and considered a classic. Board games have been around for, I mean, literally millennia in some cases, if you go back to the, you know, games of Ur. But for generally speaking, you know, a few hundred years for games like chess and Go and checkers and modern things. We spoke recently about Stratego, which is just over 100 years old in its original form and has been more or less the same ever since. When it comes to more modern games, I think most people generally are willing to accept, you know, Catan. It's a classic game. None of us, I don't think, really argue about that. But what the Tabletop Express mentioned in the chat room is the difference between classic and modern classic. And I think that's where we've kind of separated, because I'm on the classic. He may even mention Stratego before we got to it. And that's where my brain goes when someone says classic to me. Whereas both of you, I think, are leaning more towards what he was considering, what they were considering, modern classic.
Yeah, I feel pretty strongly that there are games newer than Catan that I would dub classics.
Yeah, reading Roger's question, I immediately thought modern classic. I didn't think of that term, but not even that. I just think classic hobby board game. Yes, board games have been around forever. Hobby board games are still pretty new, and Catan can kind of be pointed out as the start of it, right? The Euro game, the German game invasion, the whole hobby board game thing is still a new industry and a new set of games and a new genre. So what I think of when you ask me this, or when I read Roger's question, is modern hobby board games. So games that you're not just, you can get at any toy store that exists. Not that there's a lot of toy stores left in the world, but you walk into a toy store or a department store and there's the same games that have been there for 100 years. To me, that's where my brain went originally. Like, when you start talking about, like, chess and old ones, I'm thinking antiques, right? Like as far as, I don't know. Like the term classic isn't perfect. I don't know. I don't think 50-year-old games everyone knows and loves and knows. Everyone knows Scrabble. Everyone knows Stratego. Everyone knows those. To me, that doesn't fit the intent of the question, right? Roger calls out Concordia, which is definitely fairly modern and can easily and probably has been overshadowed by new hotness. Now, I don't know. No one's forgetting about chess or Battleship because there's a new mini game on Kickstarter.
So Roger mentions Concordia, and that's from 2013. So maybe a reasonable definition would be anything more than 10 years old. Like, I think maybe what makes a game classic is if it was popular when it came out and not just like 3 weeks of hotness, something less fleeting. Bonus points if it has an effect on the industry as a whole, like introducing a new mechanic or using something in a novel way and then making that a trend. Like, the problem here is the current nature of the board game industry. There's, what, 5,000 games coming out a year or whatever the number is now? Yeah. So there's this, you know, the constant push towards the newest, best, hottest new thing, right? And games are quickly replaced and they're pushed out of the spotlight. So, yeah, I think a game that's 10 years old, heck, I think maybe even 5 years old, could be a classic board game. I think there are definitely games out there getting forgotten that deserve a second look.
Yeah, and I think... you know, again, he did mention Concordia, which is newer, a modern classic perhaps, whereas he also mentioned Acquire, which is 50 years old and falls under my definition of classic, because Acquire is absolutely, I think, a classic game. It's got staying power. There's a brand new edition of it that just came out last year, So it's interesting. Like, one of the things I was noticing, like, when I was poking around and getting other people's ideas of classic and doing, you know, some of the research that we do for this show, I noticed that the classic book of board games was written by Sid Sackson and first
published, designer of Acquire,
first published in 1991 and is still to this day published unchanged, aside from, you know, whatever editing and new covers they put on it. So the standard text defining the classic board games hasn't changed since hobby board games existed, since hobby board games came into existence, essentially. Aside from, you know, the rare one like Acquire, which I think technically is a hobby board game, but not the modern definition, you know, post Catan that we know of. One of the things that I think of, and one of the things that's interesting to me is, you know, oh, everyone remembers Scrabble, so it can't be a classic. Except everyone remembers Hamlet.
But I never said it can't be a classic. No, I just said it's not going to be soon forgotten, which was part of the question.
No, but
I'm not questioning that the games are classic.
It's pushed to the back. He doesn't actually say forgotten. He says, you know, pushed into the back. And to me, you know, you look at something like Hamlet, which I think most people will agree is a classic work of fiction, but nobody reads Hamlet anymore unless you're made to in the school for the most part. It's there. Most people have a copy of it on their bookshelf, but they don't read it. And the same to me could be said about games like Stratego. Yeah, everyone's got knows it. Most people have a copy of it. But do you ever actually play it and think about it?
And I'm just going to quote Roger right here. Just to quote Roger, these games shouldn't be forgotten.
Someone wrote a definition in 1991 on what classic games are. You don't think that ever deserves to get updated? Come on.
Well, and to be fair,
that's like saying we're taking our classics literature list from 25 years ago and that's it. We're locked in.
I'm not saying it doesn't need to change. I'm just saying that the industry hasn't chosen to update the book. Like no one is actually making these changes. And yes,
no, I'm pretty sure Jeff Engelstein put out a book a couple years ago. Oh, Jeff Engelstein put out a book on modern games. Like it's I don't know, referencing an old 91 book before really the hobby game industry started. It's odd that book's still in print. That's all I can think of. Someone must be using it in a classroom or something.
Like it's.
As I said, I'm wondering who's thinking that's still relevant.
Different target market is my thought. That's
the thing. And part of me is a little frustrated by the fact of us being kind of niche and elitist. I don't mean that in a negative way, but Scrabble is as much a board game as Catan or Wallenstein is.
I totally agree with that.
Oh, definitely.
Like I said, argument is no one's going to forget about it. For Roger's question, it's these games are getting overshadowed. They're not overshadowed. I can go buy one at the corner store.
Yes,
everyone knows about it. Everyone knows how to play.
Like I said, everyone has a copy, but people aren't playing them. People are, especially the hobby gamers, are forgetting about them because it's there in the back. Yeah, I know about Scrabble. When was the last time you played Scrabble?
Obviously, we cannot agree on what makes a gaming classic here.
At least Sean's admitted there are modern classics. So
I think the definition of classic and modern classic is a very valid and an important decision that I think I probably should have come to and maybe we should have discussed earlier on. I wish Tabletop Express had been in on the discussion earlier today.
Fair enough. Yeah, no, to me, a classic is a game that had 10 years, 5 years ago, a game you don't hear about anymore. Right. Like no one's hyping it. No one's talking about it. There's no buzz. Maybe you can play it on like Board Game Arena, but like there's no active threads on Board Game Geek about it. There's no podcasters talking about it, however many years that takes. But that it's still a solid game that people enjoy, that if you bring it out to game night, people are still excited to play it. Or when you sit down and play it, you go, man, that game is good. Why don't we play it more often? It's more the feeling of the game. Now, Deanna brought up the whole doing something new, and I think that's part of it, too. I think some classics deserve to be considered modern classics, whatever. I'm just going to say classics. Deserve to be on a list like this because they did something new, right? Like, it's hard to overlook games like Dominion. The first game, it wasn't the first deck builder, but the game that set up deck building as a genre. Or whatever. We're going to call it other games, so I don't want to call it everyone's games before we get to them. But, like, whatever. The first worker placement game, generally considered to be Kalis. Right. That is one that I almost put on the list tonight, but I wanted for brevity's sake, I didn't list every game I thought should be a classic or a modern classic. I think those are the ones. It's those games that to me stand the test of time. That like El Grande is an old game as far as hobby board games are concerned. It's got an old look and it's got kind of dated mechanics, but then you sit down and play it and go, but this still works. It's still enjoyable. You could still hook new gamers with this. All right. Well, obviously we weren't quite on the same page when we sat down, and we don't do these lists on the fly while we're live. Some of us prefer to do some research and some prep, and Dana hates getting put on the spot. So we do prepare these ahead of time. So I will note that our list may have changed if we had had this discussion first, but we went with our original in the head definitions of classic. So, but what I want to know before we get to our list, though, this is that we don't usually do this like in the middle of a segment, but I want to know from you listeners and viewers right now, what do you think constitutes a classic? We want to know your thoughts.
My list would not change. I live and die by it. No, seriously. We want to hear what you guys think about this. Post a comment wherever you are listening or watching. Send an email to mo@tabletopbellhop.com. Hit us up on social media or let us know on Discord, which is you can find us at discord.tabletopbellhop.com.
And feel free to direct your flames towards me at sean@tabletopbellhop.com. Well, with that, let's move on to some games we think shouldn't be forgotten. One thing we've gotten better about over the years is trying to make sure the games we recommend on the show are in print and easily available. Well, that's not always the case tonight. While yes, some of these games are, there are others which may be much harder to find.
So I'm going to start where Roger started. He already gave us a good one with Concordia from 2013. I am 100% on board with this recommendation. Like Roger, this is a game that whenever I break it out, I'm shocked by how good it is. And honestly, I guess I'm not anymore now that I'm admitting it. But like every time I play, I'm like, I knew it was good, but I forgot it was this good. This is one of those games where we kind of dust it off. We play it and then we're like, oh my God. And then we invite Tori and Kat over and we play it. And like, Sean, you got to come over. And then we play with the kids and we play like a good 3-4, maybe even 5 times over like the period of a month. And then something new comes out. Right. And we put it on the shelf and we're playing whatever games of obligation or whatever. And it sits on the shelf until I'm like, someone brings it up like Roger. And I'm like, Shan, I don't think Sean's tried Concordia yet. And we break it out and we play it 3 to 5 times. And honestly, I am currently thinking of putting Concordia as one of our heavy games on our menu for tomorrow night because of this whole topic. Now, this one is still in print, but the latest edition is actually called Concordia Venus. This was Rio Grande's way to bring the game back to the market and put out an expansion at the same time. So what you can do is you can buy Concordia Venus, and it's just an expansion for those of you like me who already have Concordia. But they also sell a version that has the complete game as well. So if you are new, if you're just hearing about Concordia for the first time tonight, because people are forgotten about it, pick up the Concordia Venus version that includes the full game.
Okay. When I think about classics, the first thing that pops into my mind is the games I played as a kid and still think of fondly today, like Dark Tower, which came out in 1981, and Stop Thief, which is from 1979. And both of these were republished by Restoration Games, so I'm thinking that someone else there felt like they were classics too.
Totally fair. I think Dark Tower is especially a great one. Well, Stop Thief, I don't actually remember, but Dark Tower absolutely fits both of our definitions, I think.
I still... Yeah. I still have my copy of Stop Thief. I'll make you play it someday, Sean.
Yeah, my problem is I didn't think the original Dark Tower was that good. That's why it doesn't belong on my list. And no, we haven't played the new Restoration Games version, but the new Restoration Games version is so different from the original. I don't even can call them the same game, right? It's switched to cooperative. It's got a tower and it's dark looking, but like you're not moving around the board. You're not going to the markets. You're not getting attacked by brigands. It's almost a completely different game. So I'm not sure on Dark Tower myself. Like, yes, having nostalgia for Dark Tower is fine. But I don't know. Like, I guess it was probably the first game with an app. It belongs for that reason.
The negatives of Dark Tower are it goes for an obscene amount on eBay.
Well, yeah.
It can break down and you got to find just the right light bulb to put in it to make it work. But if you can get past that, I would still sit and play that game today.
All right. For me, again, we're jumping off onto a different tangent. I'm going to say Clue. Now, I know roll and moves are considered evil by many a gamer, but this classic game has not only lasted on its own merits for 75 years, but has inspired countless variants, which can address the concerns of many, though, to be fair, there are just as many garbage rethemes that can be completely discounted. The current top-ranked version, which is still available and is itself 30 years old, is Clue Master Detective. Interestingly, the ratings of this game, of the different versions, tend to go down as modern versions are released compared to the original classic and Clue Master Detective, suggesting that it really is hard to beat the classic.
Now, in that case, is Clue Master, how old is Clue Master Detective? Because Clue Master Detective is a different game. It's a more complicated version of Clue.
It's more of a gamer's game. Yeah, I wouldn't say it's a more complete version. So it basically took all of the different versions and put them into one. So there's more rooms and more people, but it's still the same essential game of guessing and moving around and finding the clues and guessing. They bulked it up with all the different bits from the Cluedo versions in Europe and other things. But yeah, it was 1988. It's released.
Okay, so that's still pretty old. I wasn't sure. I just know that when talking about Clue, there'll be some gamer come out of the woodwork to say, make sure you play Master Detective. It's better. That's my experience with it. I have not played.
No, Master I haven't Detective. Either, but I did do research into it because there's a bunch of different versions. Like, for instance, my family got the Harry Potter version of Clue, which was utterly broken. It literally fell apart because there was player elimination before you could guess. Although there is a different version of Harry Potter Clue, which is highly rated. And I don't know how you can tell them apart. I just know ours was not the good one.
I'll admit, Clue is one of the ones I think Deanna got me to sit down and play. And I was like, man, this is better than I remember.
Yeah, it's a game. It's an actual game. Mm-hmm. Unlike some of the things I played as a kid.
Now, one of the oldest games I have in my collection that I still love, sadly doesn't get played enough, is El Grande. This one's 1995. This is the game to me that's almost more important than Catan. Like this just predates. It's right on the cusp of the wave. The only difference was Catan got popular, right? Everyone bought it. It got the hype. I think El Grande is a better game. This is, in my opinion, the best area majority game ever made. Now, again, area majority, you're not fighting over spots. You're going for your bigger, whoever has the most cubes in an area, right? So more than one person's allowed to be in there. I absolutely adore this game. It's also did a bunch of innovations that now are pretty commonplace, but I don't think you've seen before that. So one of them is everyone starts with that same hand of cards, and those cards are your actions, and they determine your play order as well as your actions. So like if you play the 10, you're going to get tons of actions, but you're going to go last. And then once you use the 10, it's gone for the rest of the game. You see that still in modern games. And then there's the system where people, cubes being hidden in the tower, that you have to have a memory element there and everything. Like honestly, anytime I think about classic games on my shelf that need to be played again, El Grande comes to mind. And this one, like many of the games on the list, actually is easy to get again. It was just reprinted by Hans & Gluck, the original publisher, in 2023. And they were taking it seriously because they produced over 10 different regional language-specific versions. So they were trying to bring El Grande back in a big way.
Okay, yeah, I'm not going to argue El Grande is a good game, but the honest to God truth is I completely forgotten it even existed. I had wiped it from my mind. I read it in your list and went, oh yeah, El Grande. So yeah, hidden classic, hidden on my shelf, right? You know, okay. I think everyone can agree that Catan is classic, right? So, but there's a lot. I felt like to answer Roger's question, like there was a lot of low hanging fruit here. Like I could give the easy answers, right? Like Carcassonne, which came out in 2000, Agricola, 2007, Dominion, 2008, or how about Puerto Rico, which was 2002? And that is a game that I haven't heard anyone talk about in a long while. We played the heck out of Puerto Rico when we first got it. I think for a lot of people, Puerto Rico was the first introduction to the action selection mechanic where everyone gets something, but the person who chooses it gets a bonus. So it's a classic.
Oh, I agree. That Puerto Rico, I do appreciate that they put out a new edition. Though they messed it up, there were some production issues, which as far as I know have been fixed. You might want to confirm that before picking up the latest edition, but they did fix some of the problematic theming in the original game. What I would recommend over that one still, though, is Race for the Galaxy, which is, to me, the next step from that Puerto Rico mechanic, or technically San Juan, which was the card version of Puerto Rico. But Race for the Galaxy is one of the few board games I have played over 100 times.
See, I love Race for the Galaxy, but I also like Puerto Rico. Both are good.
It's interesting because we talk a lot about Race for the Galaxy, and not as much as we used to, but all the time. Except every once in a while, it creeps in. And then you mention that it's too complex now. There's too many icons. There's too many things. So Race for the Galaxy has descended a bit from where you once held it.
No, that's definitely true. It has. It's moved down a lot. Honestly, some new hotness kind of replaced it with Terraforming Mars Ares Expedition. So. I want that feel. That's probably what I'm going to go for now.
All right. Well, I went back in time again with Scrabble, another 75-year-old classic that I think is pretty hard to argue with as one that has settled into the collective consciousness as the word game. Whether it's being played on a board or on an app that someone has chosen not to license the name of, if you enjoy word games and spelling, you probably love Scrabble. Even if you choose to ban some of the two-letter words and other cheaty things and, don't refuse to acknowledge some of the modern words as legitimate and things. And again, this game has a bunch of variations on the original. The original still sells 1.5 million copies a year. But just this year, a month ago, I believe, they came out with a brand new cooperative version where one side of the board is the Scrabble we all know and love. And the other side is a modern cooperative version.
I'm not sure how I feel about cooperative Scrabble. No, I'm on the fence about that. I guess I'd have to try it.
Yeah, I'm all for trying that. New Scrabble's good. My dad was one of those Scrabble people who memorized the dictionary. And I think because of that, I no longer had fun playing it. Eventually, we got him a Game Boy Color and a copy of Scrabble and let him play by himself. My next one was, for years, my number one board game. And I would force people to play it on my birthday. And that is Power Grid. Now, this is one that really you don't hear about anymore. This one does seem to have gotten lost in the new hotness over the last few years. But I would happily sit down and play a game. And I'm sure the same thing would happen when I used to force people to play it on my birthday. And that would be players sitting down expecting a math-heavy Excel spreadsheet. It's math the game and all the bad connotations and rumors put out there about Power Grid. We're going to sit down and they're going to play it with its rope building game and iconic auction system and finish and go, wow, that was actually fun. I think of all the board games that, you know, the board game apologists, they're like, don't trust me, it's fun. This is the one where the most players after the game are like, man, that's really good. And they're like, man, that wasn't as hard as I thought. That wasn't like people are intimidated by this game. And every time we bring it out, people are like, okay, when can we play again? When can we try the German map? Excuse me. When can we flip the board over and try that side too?
It's definitely a classic. And I do feel like it's just faded, right? Because I can't remember the last time I heard someone mention Power Grid. So yeah, it's a good one. I went with Bonanza from 1997. And they recently put out Bonanza Dahlias with Beth Sobel art and a retheme that changed it from beans to flowers. And I haven't played the new version, but the blurb for the game says it features the same gameplay as original. So I think it's just a visual change. Regardless, I think it's awesome to see this game being revived. It is one of my favorites. And we've probably played it, 500 times. I don't even know, like a lot. We've played it a lot.
Bonanza is one of the games that hasn't been forgotten in my mind, because even outside of our sort of collection of fans and hobby gamers, I hear people mention Bonanza. Like it's the game that I am not surprised to hear a non-hobby gamer mention.
See, and to me, I thought it was this weird, quirky game that we found in the 90s that no one else ever even knew what the heck it was. And when I saw it being re-released and rethemed, I was super excited. I was like, oh, more people are going to play Bean. Awesome.
My only disappointment is I can't go Bean if we're playing Flowers. Flowers. Just doesn't have petals. It just doesn't have seeds. I don't know. It doesn't have the impact. No, Bonanza, I think this is a fantastic choice. It's the game that should have made Uwe Rosenberg famous, but Agricola was the one that actually ended up doing that many years later. He doesn't get enough credit for doing farming games before farming games were cool.
I went a little newer this time. I went with a 50-year-old game of Rummy Cub. This one's been around a while and, of course, emerged as a variation of the card game Rummy. Interestingly, I just learned when I was researching that it existed because the communists banned playing cards. And so they wanted to play Rummy and they made Rummy Cub as a non-card version of Rummy under the communists. Now, there have been different versions and rule sets for games over the year. The current modern game being published is known as what is the Sabra rules, but you can still find the international and American rules out there. There are copies on Board Game Geek even. And Rummy Cub was actually the second game to ever win the Spiel des Jahres. making it a pretty solid classic in my book.
So Sean is pronouncing the name of the game completely wrong. It's actually Rummy Cube, even though it's not spelled that way. My next game is Steam Rails to Riches from 2009, Martin Wallace's train game. For years, I didn't care about train games. Like, I knew they were a thing, right? I didn't realize the Power Grid started as a train game, but like, I had no interest. I'm playing Catan, I'm playing Carcassonne, I'm playing thematic games, Ameritrash. And I'm like, well, who cares about trains? What is with these board gamers and their trains, right? Then the Great Canadian Board Game Blitz comes to Windsor, and I participated. The final round, we had four of us left in the entire tournament. Deanna was at the table, as was our friend Jamie, and I forget who the fourth player was. It might have been Mike Easterbrook. And the game they present to us as for the finals is Steam. None of us had played it. Not a single one of us had ever played Steam before. So even though we're sitting at a tournament, had to learn the rules on the spot, both Deanna and I fell in love with this route building, engine building, pick up and deliver mechanics in this now classic rail game. Now, since then, I found out train games are fun and train themed games can be fun. But since then, still, Steam Rails to Riches sticks out as my favorite.
Oh, yeah. No, I love that game. And I clearly remember playing it. There was one person at the table who had played it before. And he was trying to help us learn the rules, and he was not amused when he was not the person that won at the end of that round.
Yeah, Jamie ended up winning the tournament. I remember that much. Jamie beat both of us, well, all three of us.
Yeah, the next one up is one that I've already forced Sean to play, Alien Frontiers from 2010. This was the first dice placement game that I tried, and I remember just being totally entranced with it. So when they did a Kickstarter reprint, I was totally on board. Mo's like, I'm thinking of buying this. And I'm like, oh, yes, please do. We haven't gotten it to the table in a while, but I still love this game. And I definitely think it stands the test of time. There was a 10th anniversary edition put out last year called Edition X. So I'm pretty sure it's still readily available. And it's a great game.
This was also one of the early Kickstarter successes in board gaming that kind of put the publisher on the map, Game Salute at the time. And they did a number of Kickstarters and kind of set up that, like, proved that a board game publisher could come into existence through crowdfunding. Mm-hmm. It was one of the early successes that actually went through.
Though those rocket ship dice were stupid. They just did not work.
Yeah, and that's kind of where things fell apart for that company, too.
All right, so my next one is, and this one I'm sure is going to bring up some opinions, but Connect Four. Now, some people are going to argue that this is about as much of a game as Tic-Tac-Toe. Now, I would argue that it is much more strategic, and I wonder how many people who, if placed near a game of Connect Four, would be able to avoid at least playing one game. Because part of the appeal of this game comes from the toyetic nature, the table presence, the physicality, the sound of the pieces clacking, the fun of opening the bottom to dump them all out before trying again. Is it the best game around? No. Does that stop it from being a classic? Also, no. In fact, just last week, you guys brought up Round 4, which mm-hmm. was the round variant of Connect 4. And I just recently discovered that there is a Connect 4 revised second edition that is out there right now, which not only plays Connect 4, but also plays Connect 5, as well as four other variants of the game, including the ability to push out your opponent's pieces, which really sort of brings it up to that next level and guarantees that it's not just a slightly bigger version of Tic-Tac-Toe.
All right, color me curious. I would try that. I'm amused by you saying about you put Connect 4 here and you avoid playing it. Definitely not once there's a few beers involved, which is why you see this game at breweries around the world.
Yeah, this is the game I have said many times, every coffee shop that wants me, any place that wants you to hang around and drink beverages, coffee shop, bars, pubs should have copies of Connect 4. All right, I'm going back a bit to 1989 for a game that many people lamented not being able to get for years, but is now back, and that is HeroQuest. This is the oldest game you're going to find on my list. I am talking about the original Milton Bradley Games Workshop collaboration. This is another one that's now resurrected. Not only going strong, though, and this is what's really impressing me, is not only did Hasbro bring it back through Pulse and through their Avalon Hill vertical or whatever they call that, their wing, they're putting out new stuff constantly. there is a stream of new HeroQuest content coming out every year, which is awesome. Now, what a lot of people don't realize, and I get this question all the time, is it the same? And yes, it is identical and to a fault, because there were mistakes in the original rulebook that they brought over to the new edition. The only thing that's changed is the look of the game, because they do not have licenses to the original Games Workshop art, so it no longer looks like the Warhammer world. You've got all new sculpts for the miniatures, all new sculpts for the scenery, and all new artwork on all the games, but the game play is identical. I love the fact that, like, HeroQuest is having a resurgence. Like, a new expansion was announced just this week, a brand new one that was never released, not another, you know, one that was only available in the EU that we're going to bring to North America. No, brand new content is coming out for HeroQuest now.
I'm kind of amused because this one absolutely fits under my definition for age and sort of lasting notability, but doesn't fall under the going to be forgotten, because there's all this new content coming out constantly, and Hasbro is pushing it down people's throats with you know, the way it was sold and all that stuff. So I think it's classic. I'm just kind of surprised because it doesn't quite as much fall under your definition.
You know what? I think there was a lull in between where the game didn't exist and it wasn't in print, where it definitely qualified. Does it qualify now when it's got this huge hyped new version? Yeah.
What I don't know is if people are picking up the new stuff. Like, I don't have sales figures or know how well
it's going. They have to be.
Right?
Stuff that doesn't, that isn't going to sell. Because things are still coming out, someone's got to be buying it. I mean, enough people bought the new release to, you know, support it to some degree. I'm sure at some point it'll peter out, but
there's no way they would still be coming out with new expansions if there wasn't selling.
Unless they already paid to have made and everything, right? Like, how much did they go in on Pulse?
I don't know. I think we're far enough along now that that window is closed.
Yeah, that's kind of what I'm thinking.
Fair enough. And to be fair, like, we just didn't have enough time. I was going to pull this one off the list once we talked about things. And I was going to replace it with St. Petersburg. So there, for Sean's sake, instead, I'll replace that with St. Petersburg. It was one of the classic Aaliyah games that got recent reprinting. Even the reprinting might be 10 years old at this point. That is a fantastic card drafting game, pure Euro, engine building, get your workers to get your money and then build buildings and build markets and rebuild the city of St. Petersburg that has just been burnt down. So there's an off-the-top replacement for HeroQuest. I'm going to throw out St. Petersburg because that's what I was going to replace Heroes Quest with if I had time.
So speaking of Avalon Hill, back when you were still talking about HeroQuest, I think a game that can and should be considered a classic is Dune. Now re-released by Gale Force 9 in 2019 with the new movies, it kept the classic's well-loved aspects of the game while modernizing the look and feel of it to be more in line with modern expectations for gamers. And to be fair, it's not often you're going to find something that I would consider a classic with a weight of almost 4 out of 5.
All right. I'm going with Hey, That's My Fish. It's a family weight game that came out in 2003. If you haven't tried it, you should. I have so many fond memories of this game, from playing it at coffee shops with Mo to it being one of the first more advanced games that I taught Gwen. I've played this literally hundreds of times with our kids, but also with adults. It's a solid game, one that deserves not to be forgotten. And there's a recent reprint that just came out, so you can definitely still get this one.
We've seen this one played at our recent gaming events at the Walkerville Brewery. It's been a big hit with a number of different players, including ones who thought they were grabbing Don't Break the Ice and ended up with something a little more cutthroat. I think it's a great game. It's kind of surprising to me that now it's like sold along with Uno and stuff in a small box. So I don't know if they made the chits smaller or just got rid of all the air in the box, but it's now a small box game. Now, going back to HeroQuest and classic Games Workshop games, another one that's still popular and still going fairly strong, but only in small communities, is Blood Bowl. The only reason this even ended up on the list is there is a local league that just launched just this past weekend, had their first event at Tabletop Renaissance, great local game store, and I was drooling over the pictures from this event. Now, the game has changed a lot over the years and now features more streamlined rules and quicker play, better suited to tournaments, mainly so you can do like a whole league day in one day instead of having to spread it over a weekend. And the desire to get my iced buns, the halfling team I created, back to the pitch is very strong. Since Dee's been tossing in some extra games with the recommendation, though, since we're doing that, I'm going to throw in Space Hulk as well. This one's not currently supported, but has been brought back, I think, 4 times so far by Games Workshop. So there's always a chance it'll come back, or maybe you'll be stuck with one of the previous 3 editions if they don't.
I'm all there for Space Hulk. Absolutely count that as classic for me. Blood Bowl is an interesting one. It's really had its hits and misses. It was being supported by the fans for so long with the living rule book. And then they dropped the version 3, the 3rd edition, which really kind of got a lot of people's backs up and really kind of became divisive within the community, whether or not you liked the changes, which were, you know, drastic changes to some in some degree in that 3rd ed or not.
Actually, that's not even the 3rd ed. The current edition is actually called Blood Bowl 2nd Season.
Yeah.
Which is the 4th edition of the board game. I know the video game called that the 3rd version, yeah. But the actual current printing is Blood Bowl 2nd Season Edition, which is available and supported by Games Workshop, not the fans. But then Games Workshop went and shut down all the living stuff, which is, I think, mainly what pissed people off, more so than any changes in the new edition, just that they took this fan thing and brought it back into the fold, which I understand knowing some IP law.
I mean, I'll give you Blood Bowl, but I enthusiastically support Space Hulk. Shadows over Camelot, 2005. And this one, I think, is starting to feel like it's truly been forgotten. It's out of print. It's rare. It's hard to find at this point. But when it first came out, it was wildly popular, at least around here. And I think for many folks, it was their first cooperative, we're all going to play together to beat the game sort of experience. And it was, I think, also one of the first well-known games with the hidden traitor thing. So I think that sets it apart and makes it a classic.
Yeah, well, most people consider it is the first cooperative board game, like the first big co-op game, which I'm like, Hidden Traitor to me. To me, it's not a co-op game, it's Hidden Traitor. But that's what a lot of people give Shadows Over Camelot credit to, is making cooperative board games popular before pandemic hit, right? Once pandemic hit, not the pandemic, but pandemic the board game, Shadows Over Camelot was the shining example of cooperative games.
But you could play it both ways, and we did play it both ways, with and without the traitor. So that's why I feel like it does get that cooperative game badge.
I have played Shadows of Camelot, but it has been some time, so my memory is colored by history. But it's one of those games where it's like everyone talks about it fondly, and I'm like, it was fun. Probably wouldn't turn it down, but I don't know.
To be very honest, it's a cooperative game. It was one of the first experiences I had with cooperative games. Did I love it? No, not really. But I still think it's a classic. And for folks that do enjoy that genre, it deserves a look.
All right. I, of course, before we finish up, have to include one of my favorite games of all time. That is Wallenstein from 2002. The first ever game to use a cube tower for battle resolution. I adore this Waro, and that's a mashup of folk on a map, war game, and Euro game. You've got programmed movement where you have to decide what you're going to do in your different provinces. You've got some resource management. You've got building buildings. There's area control, not majority, and more. This was, of course, followed up not too long after by Shogun, and I love both, but I think Wallenstein is better for experienced players. Because it's a little more interactive, a little harder to turtle on because the maps, more provinces are touching each other. Now, if you're new to this series, I'll introduce you to Shogun. Just ask. Then we'll bring out Wallenstein and really go to it.
So I wanted to highlight Orléans, which is from 2014, and that's 10 years ago. So that makes it qualifies, right? The buzz around this one seems to have totally faded, but it was such a big hit when it came out. It's a fantastic game, and I think it popularized the whole bag builder mechanic.
So I don't think this one disappeared because there's a brand new expansion out and everyone's talking about it.
Oh, well, see, I'm in a hole. I haven't heard anyone chat about it in a while. And I was thinking of it because I dig this game. Play it.
I haven't actually heard much about it other than us talking about it from time to time since
it's Plague. And, I think it might be Plague. I'm trying to figure out what the latest expansion is.
See, it's interesting because I'm really interested in taking a look back. So in 5 years, 10 years, taking a look back at some of these games that we consider modern classics. And I'm going to jump myself in here. Some of these are absolutely modern classics, but finding out whether or not any of them actually hold weight. Like, we are probably going to continue remembering a lot of these games fondly because we have enjoyed them. But if you take them to a newer board game group, in, you know, 10 years from now, put Orléans or, you know, El Grande in front of these newer gamers? Are they going to find them classics, or are they just going to be like, wow, what has grandpa brought? It'd be interesting to see which games make the jump from a modern classic that we think of as that to the longer standing classic, ageless classic.
Evergreen.
Like trying to get our kids to play the original Zelda games. Yeah. I should put El Grande in front of Gwen and see what her reaction is.
I don't know. Like, that's something else. Our show is now old enough. We could do look backs at games we played 5 years ago and talk about if we still care, which is something other podcasts have been around for a long time. I've been doing. There's another segment I would love to throw in the show. So it is Orléans. The Plague expansion that was just released from Capstone Games is who owns Orléans now. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I've been seeing all kinds of hype on this because this just came out.
All right. So we have had a lot of engagement in the lobby
here. Yes.
Folks have been chatting away. Thank you very much for all of that. I'm going to start off with going back to right at the beginning where Tabletop Express, thank you, mentioned the classic to me is different than modern classic. When I say classic, yep. I automatically think of Stratego, but maybe that's retro now. Dominion, Carcassonne stand out. Azul hits the modern classic vibe, although Azul is pretty new for our list, even.
Yeah, Azul's too new for our list tonight because I looked it up. I'm like, how old is Azul? Though again, like Deanna said, some games are only 5 years old feel like modern classics, and I think that's where Azul fits.
Rodney Paul Ryan's asking, would you consider Struggle of Empires a classic?
Yes, I think so. All I know is Eugene and Ernie and Neil were always begging me to play that with. And that was like years ago when we were hanging around with Eugene regularly. So
so it must have been out there for a while.
Yeah, 2004. I'm like, it's old. It's a classic Martin Wallace game. Imperialism, right? Like it's problematic thematically, but take over Europe kind of game, Struggle of Empires. It's like I said, they always call it Struggles. You can play some Struggles. You got to come to Ernie's, play some Struggles. We're not Joe's. Come to Joe's, play some Struggles. You want to play some Struggles? To me, I would consider that a classic.
So Eggman Jr. brings up Talisman, classic game, yes. With the fifth edition releasing soon.
Yeah, I just saw the announcement of that today. I wonder if they'll change anything. I will say that some of the things, like we checked out the Batman version of Talisman, and they had done quite a bit to streamline the game from the classic that I still enjoy. I have the second edition and I have everything for the second edition, including 80% of the miniatures for it. And it's been a while now, but I like to break that out now and then and play it. But for me, that's more nostalgia. And honestly, I kind of miss that kind of sandbox style game. Doesn't seem to exist anymore. And yes, I realize there were problems with it, with roll and move, and it could go on forever. But there doesn't seem to be like explore the fantasy map and have random encounters and level up to do the big boss fight at the end anymore. It's all very scripted. It's all dungeon crawlers now and app driven and fits in 1 hour session where you complete an adventure and then come back and play more. And I kind of miss that style of game.
Although
RuneQuest is the only other modern one.
Horizons. That was basically.
Yeah, but not even that. It was just fights. It was three fights. There was no wandering. There was no exploration. Mm-hmm. There were no choices.
To me, that didn't fit yourself. And I mean, no, it's not the full map. I mean, there was only so much you could do, but it was definitely a long, drawn out, multiple battles in order to build up for the big bad boss that you knew was coming.
But it was just the battles. There was none of the exploration and run into a stranger and you happen to find a clay pot and then you give the clay pot to this guy and it becomes a better item and you found a sword. Like all that part was missing. It was good for the campaign battles.
I'm with Mo on this one, not Horizons. Sorry, Sean.
Tabletop Express mentions Labyrinth. It's a bit of both. It's from the 80s, but modernized with new themes in 2024.
Okay. Sorry, I thought you were talking Jim Hansen's Labyrinth, and I'm like, heck no. Sorry, you're talking about the Ravensburger. I'm all good. Mm-hmm. Ravensburger Labyrinth is great. Again, our last event at the Walkerville Brewery, where there was a group playing Pokemon Labyrinth.
Pandemic.
That's surely a classic.
Classic with that Cordier. Absolutely. Yes. Illuminati is being nominated by Ryan.
I know. He's a fanboy. I'll give it to Ryan. It's a modern classic to you. I never enjoyed that game. My dad had it. It's a classic Steve Jackson games, originally released as a trading card game collectible to compete with Magic. But then they were like, forget it here. Just buy a box, get all the cards and play. It had some neat things going on. But I can't think of, like, there's no string of Illuminati likes that came after it either. Not in my mind. Sorry, Ryan. That one's not for me.
And he mentions Hacker, which used the same mechanism in a different way.
Okay, so there's at least one, but I think that's also Steve Jackson Games.
Mm-hmm. Tabletop Express mentioning incredible memories of the Scrabble Club.
I don't think there's a Scrabble Club at either of our kids' schools. There is Chess Club still.
Castles of Burgundy, mentioned by Eggman
Jr. Is that old enough? I guess it should be, right? They did a 10th anniversary.
El Grande.
I don't know. I could be like every Stefan Feld game from 2014 and earlier.
Grande,
there aren't very many bad ones in there.
There we go. Eggman Jr. says Crokinole is a classic by any definition.
Yeah, absolutely. Nope. I forgot Castles of Burgundy is that old. I would have definitely put it on my list.
Nuclear War, the 50th anniversary was in 2013. Yep. Wealth of Nations, one of the first games Ryan can recall having dual layer boards.
I don't think I ever played that one. Train game.
What role do classics play in also inspiring new games and the evolution? That would be an interesting discussion. I don't think we're going to get into that right now. What's the question?
I'll note it down so we might come back to it. What role
do classics play in also inspiring new games and the evolution? Eggman Jr. points out a lot of the 80s games were not good by today's standards.
Player agency. Interesting decisions. Those were missing.
Has a bit of a definition here. Something that has been around enough to become a staple in a collection or common enough knowledge among the player base that it is still remembered. That could go deeper depending on the age of the players, of course. Reverend Corian's asking if Merchant of Venus is worthy of being a classic now.
Yes.
Over a decade old.
Definitely. It's more than a decade old. Merchant of Venus is like 50 years old. Oh, okay. I'm like, Merchant of Venus is like 60s, isn't it? Merchant of Venus. How old is Merchant of Venus?
Seriously? Is it that old?
Merchant of Venus. Oh, 88. I thought it was older than that.
I'm like, 60s? No way.
Merchant of Venus definitely fits. They had both editions. Well, the new edition actually comes with the original as well.
God, read me before I mentioned. I missed the original Descent.
Here's one
we got Twilight Imperium 3. We got Food Chain Magnet coming up.
Yeah, Survive, which is now printed
as Survive. That's a fantastic. Survive, unfortunately, is dead again. You cannot get Survive. It is long out of print. That was kept alive by Stronghold Games for a very long time.
There's no more Escape from Atlantis?
Nope. It is dead now.
I remember playing someone else's copy of that.
That might be 60s. How old is Survive? 82. I knew it was old. I just couldn't remember how long.
You keep wanting to put everything back into the 60s. Came out when I was a child. Must have been 1960-something.
Yeah, Ryan called a Rex is what you really want if you want the recreation of Dune. That was the Gale Force 9, that was the Fantasy Flight reprint of Avalon Hill's Dune that was a streamlined version. I don't know. There's too many versions of Dune have been reprinted by different publishers at this point.
I mean, honestly, if we just went with 10 years old and it's a good game and nobody's talking about it, we could have put 100 games on this list.
Yeah, right? I noticed that. From like 2010 to 2013, there is a ridiculous amount of awesome games that were released.
It's almost like it was the renaissance of tabletop gaming.
I wonder how much of that is colored by you and who you are and when you were gaming and how you got into gaming versus whether or not you'd give that to a newer gamer and they would agree with you. Again, I don't know. I honestly don't. But a lot of those games are
still being printed and still being sold, and there's got to be a reason. Some of them, when they're not, I think, some of them they just faded, and there's a reason they faded. But sometimes games companies close, IPs were involved that, you know, there's disputes there, and then things don't get reprinted for those reasons. And those are the classics that just kind of crumble away somewhere and need to get talked about, but you can't go pick up a copy. So I'm so sorry. Enjoy your Shadows over Camelot.